Well, hello there. We've been talking about scatter plots to assess the magnitude of the relationship between two variables. And I thought I would talk to you a little bit today about one of the easiest ways to generate a regression line and think a little bit about associations between two variables using a data set that has been published by Professor Anscombe and the American statistician. So here we have our data. I've taken the liberty of sorting the data on the predictor value, just to make things a little bit easier for us to talk about. And what we see here is an ID, values on a predictor, the X variable, and values on the contrarian, the Y variable. Now, if you're interested in making a scatter plot, it's pretty straightforward. We select the two variables that we're interested in looking at, and then we come into the Insert tab, and we say Insert a scatter plot. And here we have our scatter plot. From this, even though we have only a few observations, you can see there's a positive relationship going on there. If we want to see the regression line and actually look at what the formula for the regression line is, that's also pretty easy. We come over here to the far left corner in the upper hand and select Add Chart Element and come down here and select the trend line option. And instead of none, we say we want a linear trend line, and you'll see that there's a straight line here that describes the regression line. And if we want to see the equation that this regression line is, we do the same thing, come into Add Chart Elements, come into the trend line, select more trend line options, and a little tab will appear on the right-hand side for us for formatting the trend line. And down here, we will select the display the equation on the chart, and display the R square of the value, that is the square of the correlation coefficient. And I can take this and move it around a little bit. I can also select this text and come back to the Home tab and increase the font size so it's a little bit easier for us to look at. I can also edit it so that it doesn't have quite so many digits and it's not quite so numbery for us. And what we see here is a formula for the predicted value of the criterion based on the predictor. That is, if I take the predictor value of 0.4, multiply it by 0.5 and add 3, that's going to give me a predicted value. The number 3 is the intercept. That is, if I would extend this regression line all the way down to where x has 0, I would be hitting it at that ordinate, that y-axis, at the number 0. Maybe we want to take a look at what the predicted scores are for these people. Well, to do that, we'll make a new column and we'll say predicted scores. And in order to calculate the predicted score for the first person, I'm going to hit an equal sign, and that's going to make the little equation part light up. Putting an equal sign in Excel says, hey, I want to enter an equation. And what I want to say here is 0.5 star for multiplication, 4 at that cell, plus 3, and I can hit return. And that's going to give me a value, a predicted value of 5 for this person, which is that value that you see right here on the line. So I'm predicting for this first person that they're going to get a 5. In fact, they didn't get quite a 5, they got a 4.26. If I want to see the rest of the predicted values, I can copy this and that with Control C and then Control V and paste it all. And here are the predicted numbers for everybody. Now, these predicted values are not equal to the criterion, as we just talked about. So I might want to be interested, I might be interested in calculating the errors of prediction. Well, let's make a new variable and call this error. And to calculate the error, I'm going to hit the equal sign and calculate the actual value of the criterion minus the predicted value. So for this first person, that's minus 0.74. So this person scored actually 0.74 lower than I predicted. And the same fashion, if I want to calculate the errors of prediction for everybody, I can control C and control V that and look at all of those numbers. Positive numbers indicate that the person scored above the predicted value. Negative numbers indicate they fell below. Here's an interesting thing about regression lines. For least squares regression, the sum of my errors of prediction is going to be zero. To kind of see that for this data, I can type equals sum and then select this range, holding down the shift key and moving the cursor, and then hit return. And I'll see that, well, within rounding error, I've got zero here. And you might think that, you know, the regression line is something that has zero errors of prediction. But there's this wacky thing about regression lines. If I drew a horizontal line, for example, I would also have positive and negative errors of prediction. It's just that, you know, there'd be a lot more of them. So any line that passes through the mean of X, mean of Y, is going to have zero errors of prediction. So I'm only going to get positive or negative errors of prediction if I'm guessing values above or below the mean of X, mean of Y. But the property of regression lines has to do with the squared errors. In other words, you and I, if we were looking at this, we'd say, well, just measure the darn lines. And I know I've got a really good line when the sum of all of these measurements is going to be at a minimum. And that's actually something called least absolute values regression. And we don't talk about that here because it's a lot of computational work. Instead, we do something called least squares regression. That is, the regression line corresponds to that value for which the squared errors are at a minimum. Let's calculate those and look at it. Error 2, and if I want to get fancy, I can come upstairs here and select number 2 and make it a superscript there. And if I want to square this value, I'm going to say, take this value that's over here and shift 6, the caret 2 squares it. And I can copy all of that and come down here and paste it. Well, here are my squared errors of prediction. If I sum all of these squared errors of prediction, I get 13.76. So the regression, if I draw any other line through the data, I'm going to get a value that's going to be larger in terms of squared errors of prediction than the least squares regression line. Okay. We can make this a little bit fancier if you actually want to know what is the correlation between the predictor and the criterion and not the squared correlation. I can do that as well. So let's pick a cell here and label it correlation, and then hit the equal sign and use the Pearson function to calculate the correlation. And you'll notice that it's asking for array 1 and array 2. That just means what range of values. We can select that range of values by using our arrow keys and selecting all of my predictors, comma, and selecting all of my criteria. And we see here that we have a correlation coefficient of 0.82. I said before that this squared correlation is the square of the correlation coefficient. So let's test that. Let's say I'm going to take this value and again square that. And lo and behold, we also get 0.67. There are many other things you can do in formatting a scatter plot to make it pretty for a paper. And that's kind of worth a little bit of time. So if we come back to our insert here and come back to our charts, I can come in here and select the grid lines option and deselect the vertical, and that gets rid of the vertical lines. If I also want to get rid of the horizontal lines, I can also do that by coming into here to the grid lines and taking the horizontal ones off. I can also put some labels on the axis. That's kind of handy, especially if you're, again, writing it for a research paper. So come into axis title statement and label the primary horizontal, and it gives me a little text box for labeling this, and I might say predictor here. And similarly, I can do that for the vertical axis. And again, select that. And that gives you a picture. Now, these data sets here are kind of nice examples because they show you the fact that correlation coefficients can be deceptive. It's not enough just to look at a number and say, well, here's the strength of the association. So let's take a peek at study two. And I've taken the liberty of making some charts for you. Here's the data from study two. Well, notice that the functional relationship is not linear. That is, all of these lines fall on a curve. And the reason that I got a correlation, squared correlation of 0.67 was because I incorrectly specified a straight line when really there's a curved line that underlies the data. Notice that the regression line you have here is also identical to what we had in the first case. Here's another picture in study three. Well, this is an example of an outlier who is also somewhat influential. That is, notice I have the same correlation between X and Y, predictor and criterion, and the same formula. But this individual is giving me a lot more errors of prediction, and they're also influential. They pulled the regression line off of what I would have otherwise had if I wouldn't have had that person in my study. So that 0.67 is again deceptive. Were it not for this person, my prediction would have been perfect. An even more dramatic example is the fourth one. Take a look at that. Everybody's down here, and I have this one person who's incredibly influential. This sole person is deciding the regression line and the intercept for us. If this person's score moves around a little bit, I'm going to get a lot different number. But notice that the correlation coefficient is the same. So there you have it, an introduction to how to think about your data in Excel, make a regression line, think about errors, errors of prediction, what a regression line does and doesn't do. I hope it's been helpful. Thank you.